nobody was talking about him. John Gormley here in Saskatchewan and other corporate media. And today I have a special guest and local notable person, Ashley Hicks. Are you still there, Ashley?
I'm here. Thanks, Jeff.
So Ashley is running for public office here for the Saskatoon Riversdale MLA for the NDP, if I've got that one correct.
Yes, that's it.
So right off the bat, the Saskatoon Riversdale has been NDP for quite some time. It is a NDP stronghold. Usually the NDP puts their best foot forward in this particular constituency. So this is the strong point. We've got a lot of the things we could be doing. This is probably the best of all of them. So right off the top, given that you're running here in Saskatoon, the alternative here, of course, is the Sask Party. And the Sask Party, it does have a candidate here. And so right off the top, why you and not him, this Marv Friesen guy?
Well, pretty much I represent this riding in a very real way. I'm a working class person that has, you know, been struggling with recent cuts and privatization to keep my family in a position where we are comfortable and not struggling. So I feel like that's quite a bit of families that live in Saskatoon Riversdale.
Indeed. And a lot of people are struggling here in Saskatoon right now. So given that, one of the big topics is, since it seems like the cases are going down, the Premier listened to Dr. Miley and took some of his advice, albeit a little late, better late than never, and it seems like that effort has been paying off. And the NDP has this platform document I've got in front of me here, the Reopening a People First Recovery, and so there is this plan for moving forward from COVID from here. And I'm just curious on that side, given the struggles we're facing with COVID, as far as the plan goes, where do you see this as being more or less over? Do you see it as being something we're going to continue to struggle with? At least as far as COVID is concerned, where do you see the provincial government going from here?
Well, we need to get people to work. So we need to invest. I know that it things might seem like they're slowing down, but if people still aren't practicing social distancing or at least being careful with, you know, diligent hand washing and stuff like that, it's happened before and it will happen that we see a cluster or a rise in cases. So I just really worry about our kind of back to school plan. We won't necessarily know what happens until kids get all crammed in back into a classroom together. And I think that's part of the missteps that our provincial government has taken.
And I notice in the plan there's talk of a 24 student maximum. And I know that there are definitely classrooms that are larger than that right now. But as far as the education plan goes, what do you feel is the limitations of the SAS Party plan? Like, what are they not doing right on that side?
So they're leaving it up to school boards without actually doing the work and coming up with a viable plan for everybody like other provinces have done. I think that dropping the onus on individual school boards like that when they're already stressed and they've already been starved for money is really a very, I don't know, it's pretty callous.
And it seems like they're passing the buck a little bit on that.
Totally. It totally seems like they're passing the buck. When schools reopen, crowded classrooms can't continue to be the norm. So I think that hiring more teachers and EAs and making sure that our kids' classrooms have the support they need to succeed in this ever-changing world is going to be very important. But I just don't think that we've seen them make good on a promise of delivering more money into the classrooms, of investing in our children.
Well, especially considering before COVID started, the teachers were already on the verge of a strike. And we're already complaining quite vocally about the underfunding of the provincial education system, the classroom conditions, even without COVID happening. And it seems like they haven't really changed anything from that. But as far as what would the NDP and what would you change, other than just to tell people, oh, go read the People's First Recovery document, what kind of message or what kind of sense can you give to people who are wondering how things can be different?
So we would just commit to smaller class sizes. I know that there is a push for more spaces for kids to be in. Our schools do seem to be busting at the seams. So I think that we would just directly invest in kids instead of, we would directly put those money into classrooms instead of doing these terrible private-public partnerships where it costs us almost three times as much in the end to deliver a school, and in the end it's not even ours. We don't even own it.
Right. And when that contract comes up, we're left with basically the empty bag of none of the benefits of investing in the future of our infrastructure, as well as the kind of a substandard education on top of that. I've heard rumors that they're not even allowed to put up posters in one of the P3 schools, which, I mean, just that little detail alone, it sounds totally off.
There's other little details. I've heard that you weren't, you know, at one school allowed to walk on the grass because they would turn around and sell those spaces to people that wanted to take photos there, so the kids couldn't utilize those public spaces and be on that grass.
And, I mean, keeping children off of grass is not an easy thing to do, right? Like, children will wander. But,
I'm sure that, like, they've moved away from that, but still, like, just to have that even there in the first place is really, is some giving a break business there.
Yeah. And is there any word on, given these restrictions, on what you can do as a teacher, as a staff in these P3 schools, as far as actually dealing with COVID goes? I know I've read a couple of things suggesting things along the line of needing to exchange the air in buildings to, or to get a HEPA or whatever filter is going, so that at least if it is aerosols in the air, that at least there's some action on dealing with that. Is there any plan on either the NDP side, or have you heard on the school board side as far as dealing with things at an air level?
Well, honestly, like, we would go with the option of probably utilizing public spaces to at least temporarily house these kids, or do like a, so that we can have the ability to do a staggered start or a staggered kind of schedule.
So at least that you're minimizing the amount of kids that are together at one time, that sort of thing.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay. So now, maybe switching gears a little bit, since the research has been coming out in favor of masks being useful, especially in crowded areas, things like schools, for example, or perhaps the NDP, have any stance on making masks mandatory? Do you feel the science is certain enough for that kind of a stance? Or what is the stance on masks and the use of masks, especially in public places and that sort of thing, at least at the provincial level?
Well, I fully support the use of masks in public spaces and situations where social distancing isn't always going to be available to us. And I don't think that classrooms are an exception. I think those are places where people spend a lot of time together in close proximity, and we should be still keeping careful and doing the due diligence behind this, you know, the science behind keeping your droplets to yourself. I think that also,
no problem. So, as well as there's a question on the line of vaccination, and one of the ways out of a pandemic like this, perhaps more for places that have bigger outbreaks, would be for one of the 180 different possible vaccines to work. We haven't got a working one yet, as far as I'm aware. But if there is a working vaccine, is there going to be a encouragement to take it? Would it be a mandatory thing? What is the thoughts on vaccines as far as COVID is concerned?
Well, I think We would encourage people to follow medical advice. We already know what the science is behind herd immunity, and people who should be getting their regular vaccines, like the flu vaccine.
Right.
I mean, we like to have a certain percentage of the population get vaccinated in order to keep those outbreaks to a minimum.
And do we know, at least in Saskatchewan, if we're hitting those targets?
I'm not sure if we hit those targets every year with the flu vaccine, but I personally get the flu vaccine and I make my family and my kids get it every year. So if there was come a time where we do find a vaccine for a coronavirus, I'm 100% sure my family and I would be getting vaccinated.
And of course, the caveat with that being, and it's safe, right? And so would a Health Canada recommendation be sufficient for you and at least your family on that side? Or is the just availability of it good enough? Or what would be the level where you would be certain of its safety?
So I can't hear on the side of the advice of my family physician and the people that are directly in charge or have something to do with my family's general health.
Right, and that makes sense to kind of trust the actual physicians involved. But in Saskatchewan, there are still people without family physicians. And
yes.
Is there anything on at least the NDP side or on your side that might help kind of address that as far as fixing the number of people without family physicians, expanding access, especially in the north, to more physicians per capita, perhaps?
Yeah, well, there isn't anything in particular that we could do except for just make sure that people are educated and they know what the outcomes are if they do and if they don't vaccinate. And I think we would just put a lot of emphasis on the education aspect of it and making sure that people know the benefits of getting a vaccination and that obviously that they're comfortable with it and they're willing to do it.
Now, as far as picking one of the questions that was asked from the community here on a little bit of a different topic, is the question of how to fund things like emphasis on education, both in terms of public health as well as the just school system, provincial education, all these things have costs. And one of the ways that the Sask Party has been historically able to pay for a lot of public services in addition to getting us more and more into debt is the high oil prices, oil industry generally, and even the People's First Recovery document points out that oil prices are low, and it seems like this kind of magic bullet of betting everything on oil isn't going to work for the Sask Party. But from the NDP's perspective and from your perspective, how do we get out of this trap of being dependent on oil and having our economy based more and more around this resource?
I think the thing that we should be doing is diversifying our economy. I mean, like you said, it really isn't beneficial to us to be putting all of our eggs in one basket. This province is actually known for agriculture, and we had a significant study being done on wind turbines. So there are other avenues that we can take besides just the oil and gas industry.
So, and then bringing it a little bit closer to home, given this need to diversify, this need to look at alternatives to how our economy at the province scale has been running, what can that mean to Saskatoon Riversdale specifically? Is there anything shining out here locally, at least on your side of the river, that might be able to benefit from that kind of focus?
Well, I mean, honestly, sunlight is everywhere. Even when we have overcast days, we still can generate some solar power. So I think that I'm pretty sure we had a solar program happening in Saskatchewan where you would get a rebate on the program, and that was axed recently, actually. So
right.
I just think that, I mean, there's a lot of different things that play into that whole scenario. I mean, my husband being a tradesperson, we've seen firsthand a lot of major construction jobs getting awarded out of province contractors when we already have the skilled labor here. And so that's why the NDP's plan to make sure that when we build roads and hospitals, that we put our people to work first, and we make sure that that money gets spent back in Saskatchewan so that people who live here can help our economy those ways.
Right. And so going a little bit on more on that direction, one of the questions I was kind of raised was the Sask Party MLAs gave themselves at least one significant raise during their time in office at the same time that they were taking their money away from cities and schools and leaving problems like what to do as tradespeople in Saskatoon, Riversdale left unaddressed. Can you guarantee, or what are your thoughts on giving MLAs raises? And do you think that that might be, even to that little extent, a little bit of a help as far as keeping these problems at bay?
I mean, obviously, I would be in support of not doling out raises. I have a firm belief that in order to get raises and stuff like that, you should be doing your job, and the people should be happy with the work that you're doing.
Okay. And so in terms of the SAS party in the past 15 years that they've been in power, what's one of the things that they could have done better or that they're not doing good enough, other than, as already mentioned, these P3 schools and diversifying the economy? What does the NDP mean to change in addition to that?
Well, we really would like to start with a $15 minimum wage. I think that getting people back to a place where they can afford to keep up with the cost of living is going to be very important. Mm-hmm. I mean, I moved to Saskatoon 18 years ago, and it was a good time. I was young, but I could still work for minimum wage. I think minimum wage was $6.65 an hour. I could pay my bills. I could pay my rent. I could pay my car insurance and my gas and still have money left over. And I think that we need to go back to a time where it's easy for people to just get by day to day without having to struggle and worry about the rising cost in groceries, the rising cost in rent, and then having to deal with the fact that you know that you're not going to make more.
Right. And that is definitely something going on, especially as a lot of people are losing their jobs right now due to COVID. Now, as far as the risk of the minimum wage job pushing jobs out of the market, do you expect that the decrease of available jobs would be more than offset by the additional amount of money going around with people working minimum wage jobs being able to spend? Is there enough data on that side to make a call like that?
There certainly is. There's certainly a lot of data to support that when you give money to a person who is absolutely on the bottom, a person who already makes the lowest wages, those people will spend 100% of what they make back into your local economy.
Right.
I mean, it's happened time and time and time again. Every time you give money to corporations or people who are absolutely on the highest end of earning, they store it. They sit on it. They wait with it. It doesn't necessarily go back into the economy like we do when we give it to minimum wage workers. So in Saskatchewan, we actually now have the lowest minimum wage in Canada,
right,
which I think is hardly embarrassing.
Exactly. And more to the effect of, like, when you give it, or at least when the SAS party gives money to these corporations, or when the corporations get these basic tax breaks or whatever, one of the things that's special about Saskatchewan, in addition to having this lowest minimum wage and all these job losses, is that we're one of the few provinces that allows for out-of-province and in-province donations from corporations to our provincial political parties, for example, the SAS party, which has been taking money from things like, what was it, Ducks Unlimited was one, the Children's Wish Foundation was another, and all kinds of groups in addition to large corporations. So is that something that you would change? Is it on the back burner, or is it just a political fact in Saskatchewan right now? As well, like, what do you think you would be able to do to oppose that? Because that is allowing the SAS party to bring a lot more campaign funds to oppose you, because they're able to make use of this kind of loophole.
Yeah, so I really, a really good question. So in Saskatchewan, I think that we would move right away to be banning out of province donations and take big money out of politics. Just because what happens is our focus stops being on the people of Saskatchewan and starts being what those corporations and those out-of-province people want the SAS party to do. I mean, I think that's fairly obvious. I don't know why else out-of-province donations would come unless they have a special interest. I just don't think that people give out-of-province money just for the sake of doing that.
And so more to that effect, to the people making minimum wage right now, to the people who are on CERB or being kicked off of CERB and who are on the lower end of the scale, what can you say to them to encourage them to unite against this obviously corrupt situation where we have these out-of-province donations?
Well, I think that pre-pandemic, more than half of people were already living paycheck to paycheck. So, I mean, the stage had already been set long before they started to blame everything on COVID. I just think that I would like to remind people how tough things were even before we had a pandemic. Even before we had a pandemic, people had a really not easy time living in Saskatchewan. Like, we don't have a rental ceiling, so people are still subject to rising costs of rent. I spoke to a number of seniors on the doorstep who get no change in their pension. Like, they don't start getting more pension just because the cost of living has gone up.
Right.
I mean, and it's tough out there for people who are on a...
like a fixed income.
Exactly. It's a fixed income for sure.
And so more on the direction of, given that it's so difficult to make it paycheck to paycheck, and given that a lot of people are falling through the cracks, even before COVID started, one of the things that has been at least available as an option has been to be, at least in Saskatoon, Riversdale, for at least some people to be drawn into this underworld of selling meth, of being involved in the drug trade, and just generally being ensnared in this broader involvement with crystal meth generally. And so, specifically on crystal meth and in Saskatoon, what would you or the NDP do to address this problem of addictions, as well as the economic side of it? There's definitely an economic side of people being trapped in that kind of cycle, right?
Of course. No, of course there is. I think that we need to definitely be putting more money into resources that are going to actually help these people and make meaningful moves towards having more detox centers and more places where people can access help. Typically, when people want to access detox, they're ready today. And sometimes they can be put on a waiting list for weeks, or in some cases even months. So I think that we need to focus on making sure that help is there when and it's available when people actually need it.
Right, and as well as like when people ask for the help. I think during my interview with Sinos, it was mentioned that there was someone there who was at the point in his life where he knew he needed to get help and went to try to get help. And at that point, he fell through the cracks. And I know there are people like that right now in Saskatoon who are at that point. And if we can't help them, then what hope do the other people who are not at that stage where they're ready to ask for help, what hope do they have? But more to that effect, so I was looking at the Sask Party candidate, the Marv or whatever, from Saskatoon Riversdale, and he actually makes one of the very few points on his Facebook or his webpage where he actually has some kind of a policy statement, is on mental health and addictions. But his approach is just basically throw more money at the problem. Now, as far as the money side, I think even in the NDP platform document, there is a suggestion that more money is coming on that side. But can you do better? Can you address this problem beyond that, just the dollar sign?
Well, we do have to do better. We have to do better. We have to find ways to continually best ourselves. I think that at this point, it's pretty easy for the SAS party to take credit for federal dollars that are coming this way, whilst at the same time not actually putting that money in from the province side. So I think that there's a lot to be said for saying that you're going to do something and then actually putting the resources and the money behind that yourself.
As well, like even when I was at the doorstop during the last federal election, there were definitely places around, let's say, 33rd and Idlewild, where people were interested in more action being taken and more dollars being spent, given, again, that we've had this Sask Party for, like, what is it, over a decade at this point. You'd think by now they would have spent that money enough for the people to not be asking for at least something, right? And so it's kind of interesting on that side that they're claiming to, after all this time, that they're going to finally do something about it. One of the other questions is on the topic of religion. And the Sask Party does tend to kind of cultivate at least an aura, or official or not, of appealing to those with more of a religious background. And at least in things like public messages during Christmas, appealing directly to God. As far as your religious background or the way you approach religion in this province, how, I guess, involved on that side are you? And is your relationship on the religious side important? And that sort of thing.
I think that your relationship with your religion or your religion in general is a pretty personal thing.
It's like a private matter sort of thing.
Yeah, honestly, like, I have a religious background. I've got a religious upbringing. I've got so many friends in so many different faiths. And I was honestly brought up to give room and make sure that I respect other people's, you know, religious content. I don't generally press anything on anybody, and I'm very accepting of other religions, so I just think that I would be taking that very cautious approach.
Right, and especially with a riding as diverse as Saskatoon Riversdale.
100%.
Yeah. It's probably a good stance to take in terms of not necessarily coming out, let's say, in favor of one religion over another, that sort of thing. Now, on the stance of that intersection between religion and public policy, one of the things in the SAS Party's earlier days was its encouragement, or at least attempting to allow conversion centers for gay youth. And I haven't heard of any in Saskatchewan, but I know there's in Alberta right now a big debate going on whether to allow these centers or not. Are you aware of any operating in Saskatchewan? And if there are, what would your stance be on them as well?
Well, I'm unaware of any, first off, in Saskatchewan, but I wouldn't be in favor of that.
Okay, so it's more a matter of, like, find an example in Saskatchewan and work from there.
I just worry that we would be unknowingly do some harm.
Right, okay. And then more on the side of the arts side. One of the questions was, in terms of Riversdale community events and art grants specifically to them, would you and or the NDP be in favor of more of these art grants, or do you follow the art grant side at all?
I don't necessarily follow it that close, but I think that we do need to support creative outlets, and that is something that certainly the arts are a very good way to spend your free time as opposed to other things that you've been bringing up earlier. Like, I just think that it's a good thing to really keep our communities involved in, because I think that it moves towards a better sort of harm reduction kind of strategy.
Right, and like actually having healthy communities and reducing harm to the community itself on that level.
Yeah, for sure.
And then another question along the line of something you said earlier was how you would feel specifically to, because one of the things that the SAS Party is going to do is it's going to hammer on the idea of they're good for families. And you've even mentioned already that you're interested in having this better deal for families in Saskatoon Riversdale. But is there anything specifically, other than the things already mentioned, a stronger culture of art, perhaps, and dealing with things like the crystal meth problem, that you would deal to benefit families here in Saskatoon?
I mean, I think always that having more childcare spaces opens up the door for possibilities for parents to get involved in other things as well. So I think that we have to start at the places where we find people running into hurdles. So childcare is one of those things, and I would move and create more spaces for kids to go.
And is there maybe more details on the how or the kind of things you would do in order to make that happen?
Well, I mean, we would obviously explore more avenues that lead us down the road of being able to find these childcare spaces, whether we think about opening up other public spaces for early childhood development people to be able to work in. I think that people will always need room for their kids to go into daycare. Wait lists in Saskatchewan are really, really long, and I think that hinders a lot of people's opportunities when there aren't spaces available for them to drop the kids in a safe spot.
Right, and like it's especially worrying when I hear of people who are being kept out of the job market because they can't find childcare. Even if they were able to get a job, they'd be able to pay for the childcare, but it's like they get stuck in that vicious circle of not being able to get out, so.
Well, and it's tough because childcare is, I mean, I don't, when I was trying to go back to work or whatever and keep my kids going to daycare, I struggled with finding a place that was affordable. And affordability is a really big factor. Like, I worked at a job that was way above minimum wage. I was considered to have a pretty good earning. But when I had twins, it just suddenly, I was not afford childcare. It was going to eat up all of my earnings. And at the end of the month, all I had to show for it was that someone else was looking after my kids.
Right. So you've kind of seen from the inside, seen both sides, so you know the scope of the problems.
I do. And honestly, when we make something as simple as childcare so unattainable, even to people who are considered to make good money. We are literally limiting people's opportunities, and we are limiting the amount of productivity and the amount that we can contribute back by something as simple as childcare.
So switching gears a little bit, one of the other questions was, so you've already been on the campaign trail a little bit and finding ways to talk to people in the area. And so what are they telling you that their priorities are, like, what's one of their top priorities? And especially, is there anything that they're telling you that is surprising you, or that is that you're learning by campaigning? I know sometimes we'll learn things that are important that we wouldn't expect when we actually go out into the community, or were you already so connected with your work in things like the Co-op Members for Fairness that you would already have a pretty good idea on that side?
Well, I mean, I just think that you can always learn more. Like, there's an opportunity to always learn more about what your community's needs are. And I actually found a number of people in Saskatoon, Riversdale, very concerned about the back to school program. Even non-program, because really is just up to each individual school board. But I think that even people without kids are concerned that these kids are only congregating in a place, and then when it's after school, they could be anywhere. And like, I think another issue, especially in Riversdale, is we've got a school opening up to three other schools, and attempting to pool all these kids from three different schools into one school, and there are a number of concerns that the parents of these students have, particularly in this climate, with this global pandemic still underway, and no real good chance of seeing it drop off anytime soon, and then them still going ahead with that plan and still deciding that that's going to continue on. We're still going to pool these three.
And so is the decision to pool the three schools being made by the school board? And is that the public or the Catholic doing it?
It's a public school.
Okay.
I'm not quite sure if it's being made by the school boards, but it is a school that is a public-private partnership.
Oh, okay. It's another one of those. Okay.
And I mean, that is just more of the direction that the SAS party is taking us. More in the direction that things at the end of the day don't belong to us, and we're stuck with a never-ending bill.
And stuck with the cost but not the benefit sort of thing. Now, we are slowly getting towards the end of the show, so is there any last message other than to, of course, vote for you and vote in Saskatoon Riversdale to put a stop to these P3 projects and inaction on COVID being addressed in the school system that the SAS party is doing? Other than that, is there any message you'd like to get to the public at large now that you have the chance and their attention?
I would encourage people to, you know, get involved and get in touch and make sure that they're having these conversations so that we can see a clear path of where people think that we should be going.
All right. And I guess that's it for today's show. So, Ashley, thank you so much for coming on today. Hopefully you'll get a vote or two from that.
Yeah, thanks, Jeff. No, that was great. I appreciate the invite to come on the show. That was awesome.
And do you have a website or something that we can send people to, other than maybe SaskNDP.ca?
Yeah, you can follow me on Facebook, actually, it's NDP, or get a hold of me at SaskNDP.ca/pics.
All right. I will try to link to that wherever this video is posted. And as well, for those of you who are listening and would like more of this going forward, there is also a subscribestar.com/Jeff-Cliff. You can help make that happen. But please, please do go vote this coming election provincially. And with that, I will end with the goodbye song. And I will see you all next week.
Bye now. just a moment, we're apart.
Goodbye, goodbye. It's just a moment. We're apart.